future of 6 million Victorians is up in the air this morning, with an announcement expected today on just how much longer the lockdown will be extended by.
For more, we're joined by clinical epidemiologist Professor Nancy Baxter in Melbourne. Thanks for your company this morning, Professor. So we saw confirmation yesterday the state shutdown won't end tonight as planned. How long do you think it will be extended for?
You know, it's hard to know. That'll really depend on the case numbers in the next few days, but it's certainly not going to be 2 or 3 days. I think they're going to need at least 5 days to 7 days. That's probably what they're going to announce. And then, you know, whether further lockdowns are needed is going to depend on the case numbers, you know, in the next week.
Sydney continues to have some issues, doesn't it? What do you think the prognosis is?
Well, you know, I think Sydney has controlled things. So, you know, if you think about what would have happened in Sydney without the lockdown measures they imposed, it's really frightening. This Delta variant is very transmissible. So they've kind of managed to get a cap on the numbers. But with the previous lockdown, the lighter lockdown, the numbers just weren't going down enough. Now, with the more tight lockdown measures, it takes a while for those to take effect, for you to see the results. So I think hopefully over the next few days, we're going to see those numbers start to go down. Mm-hmm. And more strict lockdown measures are not going to be needed. But, you know, people have to be adaptable. Like, the government has to be adaptable. And if what they're doing is not working, they have to start doing something different. And I think one of the things I would say is they took too long to decide to do something different. And hopefully that mistake won't be repeated.
So how long do you see the lockdown in Sydney lasting for?
You know, sadly, I don't think they're going to get to the numbers that they need to, you know, it's like a bushfire, right? If you leave some embers, you know, they're going to start into flames. And that's what happens if you don't kind of really drive the numbers down before you open up. The overall numbers don't need to be zero. They don't actually need to be close to zero. But it's that number of people who weren't out in the community when they're infectious. That's the number that needs to get to zero. And they're pretty far from that. So how long is the lockdown I'm going to last? You know, I don't know. But I would say, you know, we're looking more like a month than a week.
Yeah, right. It's sobering, isn't it?
A month more, do you mean, rather than a week more?
It's not going to be a week more.
All right. That's good news. The division over the use of jabs for children, too, front page of the SMH this morning. It seems as though the medical community itself is debating this and divided on this.
Well, I think it depends on your perspective and where you are. Many countries have approved vaccination of children 12 and above. So I'm Canadian. Canada has approved that. United States has approved that. The United Kingdom has not approved vaccination of teenagers. And what we've seen in the UK, you know, they had Freedom Day. And what we see in the UK is that you've had a lot of outbreaks in schools. 300,000 kids are out of school because of lockdowns, because of outbreaks in their schools. And so they become a source of transmission as well. They can get sick themselves. So I would anticipate that they're going to approve one of the vaccines for kids 12 and over in Australia. And I think to really control the outbreaks, I think they're going to need to be part of the overall strategy.
Wow. I mean, and when you say one of them, do you have one of the vaccines in mind? And just think how hard that is to overcome vaccine hesitancy when what we've seen with the number of adults who've been reluctant to get the jab.
Well, I think that we talk about vaccine hesitancy, but I think it's a bit, and you know, I think once we have adequate supply of Pfizer, I think we're going to be able to overcome the vast majority of that. I really think that we've had this period of time where we just didn't have adequate supply. And we are soon going to be over that. So what I have to say is that when you look at Canada, they had supply issues about 3 months ago. Then they got adequate supply, and now they're the number one country in terms of vaccination. And that has to be us, and it can be us. So, you know, once we get adequate supply, in 3 or 4 months, we can be the most vaccinated country on Earth, and that's what we need to target.
There are issues that you'll have to overcome in the community. There's no long-term data on these vaccines with kids. You know that's a problem. But also, you're never going to be able to make it compulsory, I don't think, in this country. It's going to be a very difficult sell. So if you're not... If you're only partly vaccinated amongst the children of Australia, does it make it as effective?
Well, you know, obviously, the more people you have vaccinated, the better. And I think that the focus shouldn't be on children like 0 to 18. I think the focus should be on teenagers who can who can definitely get sick from COVID. There are many teenagers that have died around the world. Like, it's not as dangerous in teenagers as it is in, you know, say an 80-year-old, but it's not like it has no effect. We don't know the impact of long COVID. You know, there's certainly this thing called long COVID where people get sick for a long period of time after they contract COVID, and it doesn't even need to be a bad case. So we don't know the impact of that on kids. And the other thing is schools are going to be closed all the time. So if we don't vaccinate children, their education is really going to be affected by that. Plus, there's giving it to their parents. You know, we know that vaccines are really, really good in terms of preventing people from getting seriously ill. They're not perfect, though. So if your kids are bringing it into your home, you're much more likely to get it. So I think that there are just lots of reasons why we need to vaccinate kids. And there's a way to get it done without forcing people to have their kids vaccinated.
Well, it's certainly an emotive debate, that one,
yeah,
isn't it? Professor, thanks for your time this morning.
Thanks, Professor.